Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 30th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Is the committee agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Our principal item on the agenda this morning is consideration of major ICT projects and the latest Scottish Government update, which the committee routinely receives. And so can I welcome our witnesses this morning? We have Sharon Fairweather, who's the Director of Internal Audit and Assurance, Jeff Huggins, who's the Director Digital, and Yorath Turner. Yorath, you're welcome, Deputy Director, Digital People Strategy and Corporate Services, Digital Directorate, Scottish Government. And I hope your salary reflects the length of your job title. There is no opening statement, so we're going to go straight to questions. And I want to open by inviting Willie Coffey to kick us off. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning to the panel. Jeff, I wanted to start with yourself, if I may. In your submission to us, you mentioned some spend control issues with a couple of pilot projects, the Scottish Government's payment service and telephony services, but you were looking at spend control issues and you've highlighted that in your letter. Can you tell us a wee bit more about the outcome to that? Because my intention was drawn to something you said here, that on the basis of the pilot work that you did, we are developing new thinking on how to secure greater value and improved outcomes in respect of digital delivery. Could you give us a wee glimpse of what you mean by that and what the actual outcomes were to that process?
Yeah, so the background is about 2 years ago we began to do some work mirroring work that's happening south of the border in respect of spend controls, which applies in a number of areas such as recruitment and facilities and contracts. But in this particular context, we were looking at it in relation to digital projects in terms of developing models by which we would effectively do an assessment of the decision-making that had been made in respect of a particular digital project to assess both the elements of the commercial strategy, technology choices, you know, understanding of things like lifetime costs. And we'd worked through the process both in developing, I guess, a greater understanding of how we spend money, both by doing procurement analysis and looking through through budgets, and the process effectively developed a review model whereby a team of people with expertise would engage with a program team taking forward an ICT project to make an assessment and then offer a report and feedback. And the intention with this at this stage was to be exploring effectively how to apply and when to apply controls. And again, as we discussed in March, this interacts, of course, with accountable officer responsibilities and the effectively the mechanisms by which we control expenditure more generally. And much like sort of Sharon's area of work around assurance, what we effectively have is a cross-cutting piece of work looking across portfolios, and that was the thinking. So across the summer, and I mentioned this in my March evidence, we identified two ways in which we would actually take the work that we'd done out and actually apply it in practice. And we did that in respect of some work on future telephony solutions for the Scottish Government, you know, and looking, you know, in the context of hybrid and new opportunities, and I guess moving away from things like having a phone on your desk with your number, because you might not be at your desk every day. You might be somewhere else and needing to contact people. But we also did a retrospective look at the decision-making in respect of the payments programme. Now, neither of the reviews identified any particular problems or challenges. The challenges, I think, that came out are the ones which I've set out in the letter. One of which is doing the reviews is quite resource intensive, and so it would be a process that we could probably only apply to a limited number of programmes. The second issue that we identified with that was It's difficult to move away from the individual judgment of assessors in the absence of having, you know, clear frameworks. And we have a number of those frameworks in place for things such as design standards, accessibility standards. But in terms of some of the other areas, we're still in the development phase in respect of things such as commercial standards and also data standards. And I think that what that gave us, alongside the interaction with the assurance process, which Sharon's offered you, a fairly comprehensive letter on, it just gave us pause as to whether this was the best value for money way to try and get value for money. And as you've seen in the letter, I think what we've done is we've identified at this stage a different course. Not to say that we wouldn't return to a similar spend control style model, but on the basis of having put in place some of those clear frameworks against which assessments are being made, to enable us to operate that way. The other couple of things which I'd mention is, increasingly we're also looking beyond making individual judgments of programmes to begin to apply red lines to expenditure. So things which must be done or things which can't be done. You know, so an example of that is in terms of the work that we're doing in respect of cloud services. You know, we might expect Scottish Government teams in developing new programmes to use the Scottish Government's contracts for clouds rather than to go out and take separate clouds, both in terms of value for money, but also because we can share infrastructure and support and things like that. So that, you know, that idea of a red line becomes quite significant as well.
Okay, in that answer there was a little bit that said we might and probably wouldn't be able to apply this to all project work. That's one of the lessons you've learned. Perhaps you mean by that was it too much investment to try to get that kind of information that you could then apply across the board? So does that give you any risk that you might be worried about if you don't apply that rigor across the board?
So there's a number of things which we currently do. Over the last 3 years, we've seen the development and the implementation of the Digital Commercial Service, which is a partnership between my directorate and Nick Ford's Procurement Directorate, which is intended to ensure that those engaging with digital and in purchasing and developing services have got the best quality commercial advice in place, and it's intended to do that. There will be an element of value for money, which is picked up also through the assurance process. But the broader set of issues, and I guess that's what I covered in the second half of my letter, is beginning to think, you know, beyond individual programmes of work as to actually which are the digital interventions that we want to make over the next 3 to 4 years. Because, you know, as you'll see from the schedule that you get, that there's a fairly long list of different programmes of different sizes which we're currently engaged in. And our thinking is we probably need to become more parsimonious in those things which we select, and then manage those more aggressively with the appropriate capability and resources in place to execute properly. So we're probably looking at something which lifts the approach up from the individual, we need to do this, to what does the overall system need to look like.
Okay, thanks for that. On the digital assurance framework itself, I suppose it gives rise to the next question about how then do we make sure that we've got the right people, the right balance to conduct reviews to a particular piece of work? Sharon, maybe that's one for you. I'm looking at the organogram that's been submitted as part of your material here, and it looks a fairly complex set of structures and officers and responsibilities throughout that. So I wonder if you could just maybe just tell us what that means in practice and how you would, given what Jeff's just said, choose which skills you deploy to particular reviews that you undertake?
Yes, certainly. So there are several elements to the work that we do. So one is around the engagement with all the public bodies to get the record, build the register of the projects that are ongoing out there, and to do the assessment as to what level of assurance those projects are going to need. So we have a pool of engagement managers who do that, who keep in liaison contact with the bodies throughout the life of their projects in order to maintain the register and to maintain that engagement. Where projects are identified as major projects, then the review team that is put together is led by a review team leader that is accredited by the UK Infrastructure and Project Authority. So they are skilled individuals who are very experienced in undertaking these reviews. And what we aim to do is put review teams together that are going to be able to follow a project through the life of the project. So do all of the different assurances at the different stages. And their teams may be supplemented by individuals with the right skill sets from the Scottish Government, if that's appropriate. So that covers the major projects. As far as the digital assessments against digital service standards is concerned, we've changed the approach that we've taken to staffing those recently. We used to call on individuals with the relevant skill sets in the DDAP, the digital data and technology profession, across Scottish Government, and we would pull people in for individual reviews, kind of out of their day jobs, if you like. But that wasn't proving a particularly effective way of managing the resource. So we have now seconded individuals into our directorate for a period of time so that they can work exclusively within our directorate on digital service standard reviews for a period of time. 2 years is the timescale that we're setting for the secondments, which means that we're bringing in really relevant skills into our directorate to undertake the reviews. We're giving them a different set of skill sets, you know, as a result of the reviews, and then they go back out into the organisation. And there are three different strands of skill set that we use for the digital standards that we've set out in the letter.
Okay. One of the issues that comes up and has come up regularly at the Audit Committee is the when a piece of IT, a piece of software has been commissioned right at the outset, the specification of that, the design, the embracement of quality standards, all of that stuff, if you get that right, you have a fair chance you'll get everything right. Where does that sit within that framework, Sharon? Where would that be, and where is that assurance done?
So that's the very first stage that we do within our technology assurance framework, is that initial stage, looking at the setup of the project, looking at the reasons why the project's been taken forward, what the objectives are of the projects, what the outcomes they're looking to achieve, whether there's the right level of planning in place, whether there's the right resource in place, whether there's the right skill set to deliver that. So that's the very first gate, if you like, that we do within our major project reviews, is to ensure that before we even go into the procurement phase, that the projects are set up as best they can for success at that early stage.
And that includes software development skills, ability, quality management, experience of the tools that are going to be used, all of that, or the technical side of the appraisal of whether the team is capable of delivering what the requirement is. Is that done in there?
Yes, that's what we'll look at, and whether they've got the right resource in order to deliver the project through to completion. And it's often where we have the biggest concerns around resourcing, both around budget availability and around availability of the right staff to deliver a project.
Right. Noticed in some part of the submission as well, the DAO was established in 2019, but the last time a project was stopped for any reason was 2019 as well. Is the experience you've had since then, do you feel has benefited you from identifying as early as possible whether a project should or shouldn't go forward? So are you saying that since the DAO developed this process, every piece of work that has been undertaken has successfully gone through its various stages to completion?
Well, as you say, we haven't had to stop a project since 2019. But what you'll see from the statistics that we've provided around the outcome of reviews, that only about a third of major digital project reviews go through to the next stage without needing to undertake some form of remedial action, which might be pausing the project at that stage in order to put corrective measures in place. So if we don't think that they have the right level of resourcing, for example, we'll say, right, you can't go on to the next stage of this project until you've addressed these things. And we'll ask for action plans against recommendations, and we'll follow up against those action plans before we then allow them to proceed to the next stage. Mm-hmm. So we think that is helping projects to progress to completion successfully, because we are trying to catch as much as possible as early as possible when they've got time to rectify it and before the problems build up later in the process.
And not that we're asking for it, convener, but is it possible to see that staged assessment so that if we wanted to see what the technical appraisals were of a piece of work at the beginning, we could see the review process being undertaken and being signed off? Could you see that?
So you'd like us to set out all the different elements that we look at for each of the individual stages? We can certainly provide that. That's not a problem.
I wasn't specifically asking for it, but I was just asking if it's possible to see that, if one wanted to have a look at that process.
Yeah. We can certainly provide that.
And probably just winding up my questions, convener, just about common themes, identifying common themes and issues and learning good practice and sharing good practice, which is another common theme at the Audit Committee. How do we capture all of that, lessons learned, sharing good practice to make sure that the best possible solutions are being deployed?
So there are several things that we do and are doing. We work very closely with Jeff's team. We work very closely with the Centre of Excellence around Programme and Project Management, and also within our team, we try to gather together good practice. You'll have seen from the letter, we've just recently recruited in a continuous improvement individual who's going to be focusing a lot on that. But what we also do is we do try and link up projects with other successful projects, so that when we know that somebody's undertaking a project or programme and we've seen that done successfully somewhere else, we will try and link up the organisations so that people can learn from each other around good practice. And things like, so the social security programmes have been well managed and well done, and we're drawing out lessons from social security in order to disseminate with others. So we're trying to tie in together all of those individual elements of getting messages out around good practice. We also report through to the Scottish Government DG Assurance meetings and the Scottish Government Audit and Assurance Committee, where we try and also disseminate good practice and indications of where to go for lessons learned, etc., as much as we can. Mm-hmm. But there's more that we need to be doing. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about that.
And ultimately, the DEO itself, who assesses the effectiveness of that process? Is it by results that projects are getting through to completion, they're not being stopped, they're not overrunning in budget or schedule? Is that how you would measure the effectiveness of the processes that you're applying?
Yes, I think that's a fair comment, because lack of failure is a success to us. We get feedback from the clients that we provide a service to as well. And our major reviewers are independently accredited by the UK authority. But I think for us, yes, lack of failure is a sign of success.
OK. Many thanks for that. That's a positive note to end on. Thanks very much, convener.
Right, thank you. I'm now going to invite Craig Hoy to ask some questions. Craig.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. Just a few questions in relation to the Scottish Digital Academy. I suppose I just want to explore the impact of the academy and the courses that you've put in place. The First Minister's Digital Fellowship and Digital Champions programme has obviously been launched and undertaken. What impact is that having on the ground?
Joris, do you want to take a go?
Yeah, happy to take that. So we launched the academy in 2018 and we started with around 6 courses focusing on agile delivery. Since then, we've increased that. We now offer 41 different courses in a variety of topics, including agile leadership, cloud, and things and skills. But it's also focusing on the wider skill set that people need to engage with digital transformation as well. So it's not just for people in digital roles. It's how they understand how to engage with digital projects. We've now had over 4,500 people through the academy over the period as well. And we've really shifted into how we deliver over the pandemic as well. We were fully in person. We're now very much online and hybrid delivery to enable people everywhere from Shetland Island Council to the borders to be able to access our services as well. And we've also changed some of our funding models so that we can bring in more people without having to put a barrier up for them at the same time. What we're seeing through that is better engagement with digital transformation in organisations and that real drive to push to fasten them actually and make them quicker and recognise they need the skills to deliver them at the same time. What we started with was looking at giving individuals the skills to deliver the transformation, and what quickly became apparent was actually the wider organisation needed to understand how to set themselves up to deliver an agile methodology as well. So we then started working with kind of procurement teams, HR, finance, to make sure that they had the right audit and artifacts to make sure that we knew there was good governance in place as well. The fellowship programme as well, we started in kind of 2018-19, and that's a way of seconding industry experts into Scottish Government for up to 23 months, and occasionally slightly longer if we work with the Commission if there is a need. It's worked particularly well. We've now had 10 fellows, and we're just bringing in an 11th as well from various organisations through Soprasteria, Deloitte, Digital, Leidos, and some others as well. And that's in roles which really lead transformation as well. So we've had fellows in the Digital Directorate. We're now helping Social Security Scotland bring in a fellow as well. And it really allows us to share the expertise because all of our fellows come in and give sessions to civil servants, both fixed term and permanent as well, to share their abilities and what they've learnt. Most recently, we've run ones with Alistair Han, who's joined us, who previously worked at Skyscanner and NSS, about how they built engineering teams and how that works. So we've been able to share that in and look at what's right within Scottish Government for it as well. We've still got a long way to go because we are still suffering skill shortages, just as everybody is as well. But we're investing in our own people to bring them in and try and find new pathways in as well so that they can join programmes.
And do you know what the total cost of the Academy has been to date?
To date, not off the top of my head, but I can certainly provide that to you. We run an annual budget for the Academy of around 600,000 for delivery costs, and there are staff costs on top of that. But we have worked out up to around kind of 2019, 2020, we were estimating we've saved the public sector around £2.5 million for courses which might have been procured on the open market, which are much more expensive to run.
Good find. That slightly preempts my next question. How do you determine which courses to offer in-house and to bring in external suppliers for? And what's driving the choice of course subject matter?
So we do user research with our user base about what skills they need now, but also in kind of 12, 18 months as well, and go out and work with delivery bodies, agencies, core Scottish Government, around where are your shortages, what do you need help with. We also have contacts in our procurement directorate to see if people are kind of asking for procurements with kind of the major learning providers to see if we can meet that need instead as part of it. And then we build our curriculum. And there's enough flex because we work with a model where I've got some in-house staff who deliver, who are experts in things, which means we can create our own courses. But we also work with partner organisations as well to deliver for us with flexible contracts that allow us to scale one course over another if there's a need and a demand for it.
And have you done any benchmarking to assess the level of investment that you're putting in relative to, let's say, governments like Singapore, for example, have almost adopted a digital delivery first principle? Are we lagging behind those governments that are being ambitious in their approach to this?
I haven't done formal benchmarking with it, but we do have relationships with the Canadian Digital Academy at the moment, who are equivalent-ish about public sector size. We are much smaller than them, I have to say, on that, but we are probably not as far along in our journey. Okay. On it as well, but it's certainly something we want to look at benchmarking formally. If you look at, like, UK government have recently closed their digital academy and have substituted it into the government skills curriculum unit, which is a much larger space looking at professional learning generally. So there are resources available elsewhere that we need to make sure we're not duplicating.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question, actually. Obviously, identifying as a digital academy puts it into a silo. Is there a broader suite of training provision and skills provision within the Scottish Government, the Scottish public sector, that you could come together with to create a more holistic approach?
Yeah, absolutely. And we work with our people directorate colleagues about especially the leadership skills that are needed in this space, and we're meeting with them to align our leadership curriculums to make sure that, again, there isn't duplication, that it's a clear, what's most important is the user pathway and the user journey in this, so that actually they only access the service once and it's not confusing as to where they go. It's slightly difficult, I have to say, because all of my courses need to be accessible to the entire public sector in Scotland. Fine. So what I can't do, I can't put them behind on a closed learning platform. They have to be searchable on Google, so people can find them, whereas traditionally most in-house learning offer is on a closed learning platform, which you can't find from outside of it.
And just in terms of driving take-up, could you just give some indication of the methods and methodologies and the marketing, you've identified that then one part of the marketing that you're engaged in to make sure you get buy-in and take-up within those broader range of government organisations in Scotland?
Yeah, absolutely. So we also offer a coaching service as part of the Academy. So we work with senior leadership teams across the public sector in various organisations to help them understand, one, what their problems are and whether we can help or not, and if they need some other help. And that's where we then see that change and shift. And then they're kind of becoming evangelical about it almost. You need to get on this, we need to get our teams on it and things, because the feedback is really good. But we also make sure that we're in attendance at things like Civil Service Live and events out there so that people know who we are and can talk about us. We attend conferences to share our learning. We also launched a new website this year so that people can access and book and find out what we do. And we're also sharing success stories or case studies for work we've done with Police Scotland and in Angus College, National Libraries, about what the end-to-end journey for them was and how we've helped them as well.
Yeah. And if you do push up against any resistance, be that institutionally or in terms of individuals, what typically is that resistance?
Often cost and time. So we do have to recharge for some of our services because it's we have to recoup, otherwise we have to pull back on others. And the kind of time it takes to take people through training, because it's not a half an hour and you're fully up to speed, it's a continual learning journey. And proving the investment, that is quite difficult because it's not an immediate case of if you spend half an hour or 2 days here, you can at the end of the process achieve an X saving. But we're trying to work through what those metrics actually look like now so we've got a better case to say it's absolutely proved. We know it's proved, and people in the community and learning profession know the value of it, but selling that in more tangible metrics is quite difficult.
Super. Thanks very much.
Thanks. I'd also like to pick up that theme of kind of cross-departmental working or collaborative working. And I think, Jeff Huggins, you mentioned back in March, and you I think you referred to it again just this morning, about the digital commercial service, which I think sits within your directorate, but operates as a joint function with procurement. So I wonder if you could develop that a little bit and tell us in what way that has changed the way procurement works or change the way contract management arrangements work?
In terms of the decision to create the unit was based on there was a clear need to offer expertise, not least because quite often when we begin a technology project, we take it from the perspective of policy and intent. And you know, in terms of the particular skills that we're looking to bring into that knowledge of contracting, contract management, value over time, but also understanding, I guess, the costs that may not be apparent at the outset of a process, issues, I guess, in terms of things like vendor lock-in, access to data, you know, and the commercial value of different aspects of the contract. So I think, you know, our experience has been that it's a very welcome service in that it does bring that degree of expertise and assurance, but it also brings a particular expertise into the area for those who might not be commercially minded. Yeah, in terms of how we're thinking in terms of quality digital provision across government, we're looking to broaden that out beyond commercial to have clear data frameworks in place, clear architecture frameworks. We already have the design framework, but also to think and be a bit more explicit about our capability framework as well. So in addition to the work that Sharon's team already does in making an assessment of teams, to actually understand across each of those five domains that there needs to be an appropriate set of arrangements in place, a clear understanding of what's required, and all of those things have to happen effectively if you're going to get the good outcome that you want alongside good program management. So we've taken the idea from the digital commercial service and begun to extend it, you know, across those other domains in such a way to try and tie what we're doing at a government level together, as opposed to seeing it developing independently in different parts of the organisation.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that the Auditor General has been speaking about is the ambition of more innovation in the public sector. And even use the expression risk taking. I mean, do you think that you are doing things which are innovative, which involve taking some risk, calculated, I presume? But
I think there's different ways, and I guess different areas in which we take different approaches. So fundamentally, I'm keen to do some really dull things, which are about effective program delivery, which delivers good services for people. Most technology that we use on a day-to-day basis is relatively straightforward. You know, we do things like we make a payment, you know, we apply for something, we look for a license, you know, we might update a record, we might make an appointment. You know, none of these technologies are out there innovative. The challenge is to make them work really well for citizens so that you don't notice that they're happening, so that they just become part of how you do your life. And that requires a lot of, you know, hard work in terms of design, you know, data management, architecture, It's things like the work that we're doing on citizen ID. It's things that we're doing on cloud. But most of the stuff that we're doing is, I'm really sorry, but it's really quite dull. And you know, ultimately, our objective is that most of the things that we do, you don't notice because they just become part of your expected life. At the same time, I then have a lovely group of people over in CivTech who are doing innovation exactly for things out there that you might not have contemplated or thought about, which have the potential to build businesses in Scotland. And have the so running over the next period of time, two challenge cycles a year. So the challenge cycles in CivTech 8 are focused around a range of environmental challenges. We're asking people to think beyond the normal. And you may have seen some of the coverage on the BBC in terms of using sensors and technology to track beaver burrows, which I'll confess I hadn't imagined would be a business at some point in the future, but it would appear there's a technology there which has the potential to grow the economy, solve real problems, and is very much in that innovation space. So it allows us to do, I guess, that innovation in a controlled space over here, while doing the really important and very dull work that we try and do in digital over here at the same time.
Thanks. I mean, you mentioned in the passing there, citizen ID. Could you tell us what that is?
It's the piece of work that the Scottish Government's been working on since about 2017 to effectively give the individual who wants it an identity which they control, including the use of and the information related to it, so that when they come to log on and apply for a benefit, that they can basically demonstrate who they are. So I guess a key example that we've seen of that over the last two or three years would have been your COVID passport, status app, which basically enabled you to demonstrate that you had what your vaccination status was. But it also had to know that you were you, so that you weren't just running around with a piece of paper that said, Joe Bloggs. So that ability to verify that this person is that person and to use that in the digital landscape, I guess it's a bit like your bank login. The proposition is that it enables you, having created your identity and used it for one purpose with government, that you can then use it as you choose under your control for other purposes. So it's quite interesting because it's a piece of work that Sharon's, and I thought of mentioning it in the earlier question, team reviewed in the summer of 21 as a piece of work that was going on then. And it was one of the reviews which came out fairly red. And we had a long think about whether to continue with the programme or not. Over the last 14 months, we've taken it from being fairly red to being amber green in terms of review. And the work will go live in February of next year with Disclosure Scotland, and will be a mechanism that they use as part of their process of issuing disclosure certificates. But the intention then is, if you've created an ID for that purpose, you might want to use it for another purpose. So it's intended to get away from the fact that for every service you access from government, you've got a different login and a different password, and having to remember that, so that you can in fact seamlessly move between services.
But I mean, if I take myself as an example, I've got had a COVID passport. I've got vaccination certificates and so on. So do I have a citizen's ID?
Not at the moment. No, you don't. You effectively, what you have is you have those different things. The choice down the line is, if you wanted to have a thing which you could use to do more than one thing, you could have it.
And you don't think primary legislation would be required in order to do that, for example?
It's entirely within the control of the citizen. So no, there are. The UK government is considering whether it requires, because it is also doing work in this area under the One Login scheme, and they're considering whether they require legislation for some aspects of the scheme, and we'll continue to follow that. But in terms of where we are with the process and the decisions we've made so far, no, we don't require primary legislation.
Okay. Craig, why did you want to come in on this?
Yeah, just a brief question, if I may. I think when you last, before us, second, so you referred to the cost of the COVID passport scheme, and there was the cost of the infrastructure and the architecture for it. Do you know if the final published costs included what I think you referred to? There was a fee per person that registered that I think was paid to a third party agency or something in terms of that verification. Do you know whether or not the total published cost of the scheme ended up including that nominal subscription fee per registrant?
I'll be honest and say I haven't seen the final costs, but the one component of the cost, and I guess this is one of the components that we want to not have to pay again and again, is the process by which they used a particular product to verify that this person is that person, you know, using biometrics, if you recall, and the, you know, the cost per item of that was, I can't recall, but it was more than £1. So imagine every time if you created a new login for a new service, we had to pay that £1. The idea is once you've done that,
right,
you've done that.
Right. Thanks.
Thanks. Before I pass over to Colin Beattie, I'd also like to take up a question about one individual project which came out in the July summary, and that was the Highlands and Islands Airports Limited Air Traffic Management Strategy Programme, the Remote Tower Solution. In the narrative in the report, it says that this project has been paused. I mean, my understanding is that it's been abandoned. So, my first question is, what is the status of that project? And secondly, £45 million of public money had been allocated to it. What's happened to that £45 million? Sharon.
I don't have the answer to the second part of your question. We can certainly come back to you on that. My understanding is that the programme has now been, they're now rethinking the programme. You'll get your next 6 monthly update in the next, before Christmas. So you'll have a further update on that in the next couple of weeks, which will give a clear picture of where the programme is. But my understanding is, yes, that they're rethinking the whole programme.
Okay, but that will still be listed in the updated...
Yeah, you'll have a follow-up on in the next update that you get in the next couple of weeks. We'll have a follow-up to it and the current position.
Okay, well, I'll keenly look for the language that's used in that. Okay, I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. historically, there's always been a shortage of skills. There's always been a shortage of bodies in the area of digital posts. I presume that still continues, as far as I'm aware. So how do you recruit people for these posts? And how do you specifically ensure that the mix of skills and resources that you need are within that recruitment process?
I'll offer something at a higher level, and then I'll bring Yorath in more specifically on the recruitment process. So what one of the challenges that we've identified is that, and I guess the quantum of resource against the number of projects, there's two ways to solve that. You can have more resource or you can have fewer projects. And you know, I think one of the things which we need to look very carefully at is whether we're trying to do too many things and whether we should scale back the activity to the capability that we're likely to be able to have and the resources which are available. Partly because my experience is that when we overextend ourselves, then we reach into the contractor market and the managed service contract market, and those begin to raise the cost of delivering a programme and begin to reduce our control. So I think at a macro level, one of the challenges which I'm seeing for 2023 is to begin to think, what's the size of the programme, and can we ensure that we're not sizing the programme at a size which is bigger than the capability to deliver? Because I think those things potentially can get out of whack. And partly that's, I guess, in the context of lots of individual decisions being made as to what to commence, which then takes us into the situation where I'm competing with Sharon and, you know, I'm competing with Health for the same resources. So we need, that's, I guess, one of the things which I was alluding to in my letter, is we need that corporate understanding of what we're collectively trying to do and to size it within the capability. The other, Yorath's already referred to some of the work that we're doing in respect of the digital fellows that we've brought in terms of having a really good understanding of what team composition should look like and how we both the individuals and the structures. And I guess in my mind, quite often I would think more at the team level than at the individual level as to how many teams I've got in place to do digital activity rather than just at the, you know, how many architects or how many programmers, because ultimately the unit here isn't the person, it's the team. But Joris can say a bit more about the work that we're doing on recruitment.
Are you still paying off-scale to recruit people in the digital area?
What do you mean by off-scale?
Well, several years ago, you were paying, according to a civil servant scale, for people coming in to technology. But then, because of the shortages, you took that off-scale and started to pay according to market.
We offer an allowance for DDAP professionals, which at the moment I think is...
For our B and C rounds is £5,000 on top of standard salary scales.
So we work with standard salary scales, but an allowance which reflects the market dynamics.
And you're satisfied that brings the salaries to a level that are competitive?
I'm going to bring Joris in, and I am, because we've worked through this very carefully, because one of the big questions for me is where are the challenges in recruitment? Is the challenge that we're not paying enough, or is it that we're not offering a good enough job? And you know, I think what we've been working through has identified that we do pay well enough, so we need to work on the quality of work, which we've been doing, and the recruitment process. But Joris is the expert on this.
So I did a full benchmarking exercise in kind of March, April this year, because there is a business case for the allowance that we do gets renewed. And that was using the Aon Radford Global Compensation Database for kind of market rates for all of our roles. And that's what the adoption of the digital data and technology frameworks allowed us to do, because we've standardised the roles that we have in teams across. And it showed that whilst there are outliers, generally, we're not too bad. We're around 60% of our roles pay between the 25th and the 75th percentile of the market rate. Where we really see differences is in our most senior posts, which is not unexpected, and in our more technical spaces like cybersecurity and architecture, development operations and things like that. But what we did as a result of that benchmarking was increase the allowance from what was £4,000 now to £5,000 to address that, to bring that in line of where they were. But our turnover rates are much, much lower than industry comparatively. So actually, once people come and join us, they tend to stay. So in industry, it's around 18%. Ours is around 8%. What we find, whilst there's internal churn as well, actually the work that people get to do when they're with us is what is most rewarding. And so that's why what we've done as well is develop a business case to implement a specialist recruitment service to bring in digital people, recognising that the market is very competitive in this, and most people in the space have got multiple job offers and can't wait for our usual timescales. So we need specialist people who know the market and where to talk to people and sell what our employer value proposition is about why it is so good to come and work for the Scottish Government. Even if you don't stay for 20, 30 years and you're only with us for 2-3 years, that's absolutely fine, and we really love you to come as well. And so we're embedding that at the moment, and we've been working over the summer to define that service model using people who've got digital market expertise and know how to do the candidate management of people, and it needs much more active engagement and shortening of timescales as well, because the people aren't waiting around, and we need to make sure we're changing our systems to account for that as well.
Given the competitive market, you wouldn't think £1,000 extra would swing it one way or the other for a senior IT person.
You wouldn't necessarily. We have also changed some other things. So it used to be paid after a 9-month qualifying period. We have now changed that, so it's paid after 3 months, but it's retroactively paid to their start date as well. But it's not all about the salary level, because if I'm perfectly honest, we're never going to compete with some of the biggest payers. I don't think as government we really should be trying to at times. What we try and sell is, one, as I said, the work that people can do, but also the additional benefits you get for working in the public sector, which is the additional flexibility about when you work, where you work, the additional holiday allowances, potentially the pension contributions you would get as well, because there are other benefits for working in the public sector.
Yeah. One of the things that I've been aware of, having been in the private sector previously, was employers encouraged employees in this area to move on after a period in the job. The reason being, they go out there, they get more skills, more experience, a broader exposure, and then they come back in a few years' time with much higher skills. What you don't want is somebody that's going to settle down for 20, 30 years and just be in that groove and tick the box. Is that a consideration you've taken?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why we've implemented our career pathways using the DDAP framework so that people can see the skills they need to develop. And we support them through the academy and others to develop those skills as well, to move around internally, be that in digital directorate, in agriculture and rural economy, social security, and also support outward secondments where we can, as well as inward secondments, so that people can go out to industry. And we also and looking at how we use the kind of reinstatement rules potentially so that people can go to private sector and then come back to government within the limits set out by the Commission that allow them to do that and build those skills and support, and really changing our thinking to say, even if we're building the skills in the sector, in the market, if they leave us, they still retain in the sector, and Scotland needs that. There were 22,000 digital jobs advertised in Edinburgh and Glasgow last year, according to Accenture. And we're never going to meet that on our own, and we need to work together as an industry to help meet that need.
Can I maybe add to that? So it is quite interesting as a challenge, because in terms of recruitment, because I guess historically the model of civil services, there's a lot of candidates applying for a small number of jobs, and we need to apply some very fair and transparent processes. In this area, many of the people in the digital world never apply for a job. That they get approached on LinkedIn, they get tapped up by a friend in a different company. And so, you know, and I've seen applications in other areas where they say almost they don't fill any of the competences, they don't give any, because they're in a very fluid market where they, you know, effectively. What we then have done is we've done research as to why people join, to actually understand why some people in the context of, you know, government or the NHS, or, you know, which seems like an odd thing to do if you're a technologist, why do people actually join us? And the two main motivators are the work is of value and they take a long personal value for it. And the second is they get to work with people they want to work with. You know, so that means the environment that you're working in needs to be effective and needs to be productive in that process. So it is quite. I think the 2 to 4 year element, it also requires us to get into a situation where we don't presume we've recruited somebody and we've now got them. You know, it does take us into a situation where I think over the next 3 to 4 years we're going to be engaged in a lot more continuous improvement as people effectively rotate through our system and back out into the private sector, you know, as you describe, which is really desirable. But it requires, you know, our approach to how we're actually sort of, you know, managing that flow to be quite different from what it would be traditionally for civil servants.
Can I ask for an interpretation in your letter, actually, Jeff? You state target support and greater control of digital capability. Is that simply about sharing resources and people?
It's a bit more, and it comes back a bit to the point that I made earlier as to whether we're trying to do too many things some of the time. And, you know, certainly in talking to the Minister, Mr. McKee, and talking to JP Marks, the Permanent Secretary, you know, they clearly think that we should be managing our capability across the organisation in a different way than we currently do. And so the conversations that we've been having, and, you know, which we'll have next week again at the Digital Board, are beginning to think effectively about how we actually do that, both in career development, but also in allocating people to priority areas of work. So we're not quite there yet, but it might be a bit more than just having a nice chat, if that's your question.
Just moving on to a slightly different thing. You've touched on the need to prioritise projects and so on. How do you decide which projects are going to be prioritised? What's the criteria used? And, you know, it's not just about whether you've got the right skills or so on available for that project. Projects in themselves have a priority and need to be staffed in order to deliver for the public good. So how do you do that prioritisation process?
So again, we've identified, that's another of the items that we'll talk about on Monday at the Digital Board, and which will be part of the work programme for 2023. And in my mind, and, you know, this isn't the settled position, because we'll continue to work with colleagues to get to a settled position on it, but in my mind there's 3 or 4 elements to it. So first of all, there's a non-digital element to it, so we need to understand the business need of the organisation to achieve public good. So it needs to be somewhere, and it needs to be have a priority in terms of the government's programme. The second thing which I'd bring in terms of the prioritisation is the degree to which making the change or taking the programme forward contributes more broadly than the programme itself. You know, so if we think in terms of the capability to create new data sets or to create new processes which might be used for more than one by more than one organisation and might be used to create infrastructure that's used by a number of organisations, something which adds to the overall system as opposed to simply solves an individual problem, again, is a key one. And you know, one which you know the committee will be familiar with is our ability to bring data together from multiple systems. You know, so the challenge that we have that data is you know, over here in one bit of the system and over here in one bit of the system, another bit of the system, and we need both those bits of data to make a decision. So that's a common problem that we have across government, whether it's in health or whether it's in justice. And so finding solutions which solve common problems also I would give prioritisation to as well.
I mean, you've got an enormous number of projects. The resources needed to prioritise these must be considerable.
Yeah, it's again, you know, as we look into it, and you know, part of the challenge is that we don't get to start with a green field and a blank piece of paper. So we have a stock of the projects that you have in front of you as the list. But in terms of how we consider what gets added to that list, you know, next year or the year after and the year after that, you know, focusing on fit, focusing on value, but also being quite clear that we need to cut our cloth to ensure that we have the capability to deliver these projects efficiently.
So you assess the pipeline rather than the existing projects and the impact they're making?
I think we need to do both. You know, I don't think we can do one or the other, but the processes that we apply between the two might be different. And the other aspect of this is I don't think it's purely my job as Director Digital to make that assessment in that these are also business decisions. They're not just digital decisions. And I think that's part of the objective that we have, is to be able to blend that business decision with the digital decision. You know, because ultimately, as citizens, you know, we live our lives across multiple parts of government. You know, and so the system needs to be orientated in that way to understand it from the citizen point of view.
So who makes the business decision?
I would push that fairly far up the organisation to what we might describe. You know, there's a question as to whether that should sit with the executive team in their in as part
Who's
of their.
Who's making the decision now?
The decisions at the moment, and we discussed this in March. Each of the decisions at the moment are largely made within individual portfolios, you know, and individual directorates, and under the accountability arrangements under which we allocate resources out to DGs and then down to directors, and they sit within the ministerial portfolios. You know, what we're suggesting is that we need to step beyond that to actually understand the system of impact of that, and to begin to think about it at a system level.
Is there a time frame?
I think as I've referred to in my letter, we meet on Monday as Digital Board with the objective of putting in place a work programme for 2023. You know, this is not a small change in terms of what we're considering, and it's a change to how people currently operate and what they do and what their accountabilities are. And so what we've agreed is that we'll set out the initial work plan for 23, which will begin to get into the areas of prioritisation, portfolio management, you know, the frameworks that we apply to actually support the change processes and effectively create this as a programme, not just as a policy or as a strategy with an SRO appointed to take it forward. But I think, as I've indicated to the clerk, you know, as we work through this, I'd be very... very happy and to come and talk to the committee again about that.
I think the committee would be interested in how this progresses, because the process at the moment still seems a bit fragmented down to departmental level. Let me just conclude by asking you one simple and easy question. The R100 programme, the savings from that, what does that mean for delivery?
So what we've done with R100 is effectively, for a couple of reasons, we've effectively reprofiled the delivery of the programme. We'll actually probably cover more than we had intended originally, but the period over which the programme will be delivered will be different, and it comes back to some legacy issues in respect of supply chain and COVID in previous years, but the intention is that we'll still continue to deliver R100 as previously set out. We're expecting, as part of the reprofiling, that we'll be able to offer broadband to an additional 2,600 rural properties, mostly in the Highlands and Islands. But effectively, as we've, I think, already put in the public domain, the programme itself isn't in any way reduced. It's just will be extended over a slightly longer period of time.
Okay, leave it at that. Thank you.
Right, thank you. Can I just take you back to a couple of points that you have made in your answers to Colin Beattie, just for clarification. First of all, if I take a project like the Highlands and Islands air traffic management system change that was proposed, or if I look at the series of Police Scotland IT initiatives, which are listed again in the programme, I think there are four of them currently, do they get ministerial sign-off?
These are programmes of work which will currently sit within their own accountability structure. So the Police Scotland will have their own accountability structure. The allocation that they receive, they then operate under the delegated assurances and authorities that they have. So I don't know whether any individual particular projects have been in front of ministers, but I would say that within the powers of those organisations that they have the power to take forward projects.
But isn't there any kind of threshold that requires ministerial approval? I mean, look, we've been discussing in the context of the ferries the role that ministers have clearly played in the signing off of the award of contracts or the award of the status of preferred bidder and so on. So I'm just trying to understand in this area of ICT whether there is an equivalence, whether ministerial sign-off is a part and parcel of the routine way in which these projects are given the green light.
I think for external NDPBs, I think they've generally got the authority to take forward work within their delegated authority, their budgets and the framework under which they're expected to operate. So I think it's a no. I don't think they do go to ministers. I'm happy to write if I'm wrong, but I think that's as I understand it.
Okay. I mean, if on reflection you think there is a nuance to that answer, then please, Mr. Huggins, come back to us. The other thing you mentioned there as well was the digital board, which I think you said was due to meet soon. That's a board which is ministerial-led, isn't it? And I think COSLA are involved too.
So it's a board which is chaired by an external Lindsay Montgomery. At the previous meeting on the 29th of September, the minister attended and with myself gave a presentation. In terms of how we saw the future developing. There's a question as to whether in 2023, when it probably becomes the Digital Programme Board, as opposed to the Digital Board, whether at that point the Minister wishes to chair it himself. So I'll have that conversation with him sometime in the next week or so. But he's fully up to speed and informed of what's going on at the board. And I spoke with him last Friday to talk through the approach that we're taking next Monday.
Yeah, sorry. I mean, I thought when you gave evidence in March, I thought what you had said was that there was, understandably, an officials composed group that has oversight of these things. But I thought you said that there was a ministerial-led body as well, which had, I think you said, COSLA were involved in that.
Yeah, there's the joint board which oversees the digital strategy, which is a shared strategy between the Scottish Government and COSLA, and that met most recently about 2 weeks ago, so that does also exist. Its focus.
And who chairs that, Mr. Huggins?
It rotates between the minister and the council spokesman for digital, and it's identified priorities. Four priorities: digital inclusion, connectivity, common componentry and the work of the academy. So it's very much focused in those areas of activity, but effectively it's a political clearinghouse to assure ongoing delivery of the strategy, but also potentially to address any challenges or difficulties that we're having between different parts of the system. The Digital Board is a Scottish Government entity which is intended to get ourselves organised to be effective in delivering digital. And it also, you know, it has representatives from the local government digital office in attendance. It also has representatives from the agencies group and from the NDPB's group. And one of the discussions, I guess, going into 23 is also the degree to which it, you know, how far its reach is in terms of the next stage of work. And it, I guess that comes back to your previous question about Police Scotland and NDPBs.
Yeah. I mean, and presumably these bodies have terms of reference, and would it be possible to share those with us?
Happy to share the current terms of reference for the digital board, but I suspect we'll have new terms of reference in February, which reflect the changes that we're making. So whichever you would wish.
Or happy to see the ancient and the modern, and okay. We can then compare the two. Thank you. Sharon Dowie has got some questions for you.
Thank you. Good morning. I wanted to ask you about Social Security Scotland. Now, so far, that seems to have been classed as a kind of good news story as far as systems are concerned. But in day one of the launch of the new Scottish Child Payment, the system crashed. So it was just to see if you could tell us a bit more about what happened and any learnings that you've taken from that.
Happy to do that. I've had a good conversation with a number of colleagues at Social Security to properly understand it. So the first thing I should probably say, the system didn't crash. The timetable effectively on the day is that the new benefit, the child payment benefit, launched at 8 o'clock on the 14th of November. At around 10 o'clock, 150,000 SMS notifications were issued to people, including a web link that allowed people to go onto the site and to begin to make an application. And a lot of people clicked that link at the same time. And what happened next was that the system understood that as a denial of service attack, because it wasn't expecting quite so many. And the protective measures that we have in place for the system effectively kicked in, and the system closed down, believing that it was subject to some form of cyber attack. Whereas, in fact, what had happened was that many of 150,000 people had done exactly what we wanted them to do, which was to go on to the site. So the site was off for about an hour and 45 minutes. During that time, telephone applications were still operating and still being taken forward, but the corrective action was taken by 11:45 and the system went back on. So looking forward, we've got different ways in which the agency might approach that in the future. So they might stagger the process of issuing SMS. You know, they might calibrate the DNS protection at the point in time whenever they're likely to be receiving a wave of applications of that kind. But you know, they'll now learn from the process, make sensible decisions, and we would expect not to have that problem again. But clearly, the system is capable of scaling for the demand. And the system was robust in every other way. So, I guess it's an example of where we've applied a protection in the system against a particular threat, which has given us a different problem. And that's probably just part of the, the agile learning process that we need to be involved in. They had 89,000 applications in the first 2 days of the process, which is not a small number. And again, in that context, it's an interesting piece of work, and you may wish to hear more from Social Security on it, because again, in this case, also looking at the process by which they were able to automate additional elements of the application process in such a way to process quickly and at a lower cost per transaction in terms of doing that, which again are all the sorts of things that we expect digital to do. The first payments were made on the 21st. In the week commencing the 21st of November. So in terms of that, so the story's probably not as reported. It was sort of quite interesting because, as you might expect, various people who run SMEs and private sector companies regularly email me to ask me for meetings to help me solve my problems. And while I appreciate the generosity that they offer me in this case, a number of the emails which I got did seem to suggest that they thought that they knew what had happened and that they were now going to solve this problem for the future, whereas in fact, the story is probably a lot more straightforward. And I think we can have confidence in the people at Social Security to get the future right on this one.
Thanks. I know you're saying the system didn't crash, but to the normal person in the street, when they don't get access, they would have thought that the system had crashed. So were you not expecting to get everybody applying for it at the same time then? Because it was highly advertised in advance. We were all told to advertised it in social media, so you were kind of expecting it. You would have been expecting 150,000 applications should you have done it a different way in the first place.
So they received 89,000 applications over the first 2 days, many of which were on the telephone because not everybody will use a web link. I think the learning point is the process by which they give access to the web link, which just, you know, and again, it's this frictionless government aspect of it, which is you make something easy and people will use it in a way in which, you know, because if you imagine historically what you'd have needed to do to apply for a benefit and, you know, the documentation and things like that. I think the learning point is people will take up an offer like that. And I think if they hadn't put the web link out, they wouldn't have had the same volume at the same point in time, you know, because, you know, this is not just a lot of people applied in the first couple of days. A lot of people applied at 10 o'clock or a lot of people clicked the link at 10 o'clock. And you know, that's, you know, that's the learning point. In terms of that. And, you know, with things like SMS, you can stagger the delivery so that they're going out at 5-minute intervals and batches and things like that. And that might be their solution, or they might just recalibrate the DNS protection for the future. But,
do you know where we are in uptake for it for people that are eligible?
Pardon?
Do you know where we are in the uptake of it for people that are eligible?
I don't have that figure. I do know that there's been 89,000 applications in the first 2 days, and I do know that payments were made before the end of November, and the week commencing the 21st. I don't have those figures, I'm sorry.
No, just another one, you touched on some of data collection with Colin's questions, but obviously at the moment we're in the cost of living crisis. We're continually hearing of people not claiming benefits they're entitled to. Where are we with data collection for the new social security system to make sure that people that are entitled to benefits can get it automatically rather than having to go in and click in links or SMS messages on the day that the new benefits go live?
So this is one of the areas where Social Security is under particular duties to maximise benefit take-up and to make it straightforward. There's challenges with this area, though, because of issues to do with GDPR, privacy and choice. And so that's why, you know, telling somebody this may be something which you're eligible for works quite well as a methodology, rather than saying here is a benefit that you are entitled to. Because, again, people do have to make that decision to actually apply. Also, the latter is more likely to be subject to things such as fraud as well, and things like that. So the agency is continuing to work through different ways in which they can better target and make people aware and say, if you have this, you might get that, you know, that sort of approach. But it's an iterative process. And I guess the other side of it is also doing it in a way that people feel comfortable with as well, because, again, people may react differently to being receiving information about eligibility, and so I think there's design elements to that as well.
So is there a fact did some people get an automatic entitlement to the Scottish Child Payment, or did everybody have to apply?
People will have to apply.
So none of it was automatic?
The process in terms of application was for those who were then eligible, because of course it's based on an access to another benefit, that having made the application, then the process is very straightforward. But people have to say, I would want that benefit, because at some point they have to sign to indicate that they consider that they're eligible.
And just in the reverse on that, you'd said about fraud and everything as well. Is there something in place in the new system to make sure that once people are not eligible for the benefits, then that benefit would stop? So if somebody went into full-time employment, or if children reached a certain age? So
Social Security Scotland will have a range of measures in place, both to ensure that they're continuing to assess eligibility, but also to prevent fraud. But I think I'm probably stepping outside my expertise to try and talk about their programme. They're a mature programme running this effectively.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just finish on... Sorry, Willie, I'm not going to finish. I'm going to allow Willie Coffey to come back in and then I'll turn to my last question. Willie, over to you.
Thanks very much, Convener. Jeff, it's just on the issue that Sharon was raising there. It sounds from your explanation that we didn't carry out any kind of advanced load testing in that system, because clearly that would have and should have identified that the system thought it was a cyber attack. So why did we not do that in advance?
So I know the Chief Digital Officer at Social Security, and they will have undertaken load testing. I think the challenge, though, is undertaking load testing on a live system. And effectively what they've, what, you know, I guess the, you know, the, the mental construct, so we'll now always forever after look at this in a different way now. You know, just having had the experience, and we'll think differently about DNS protection, I guess, as well, and understand where it fits into the process. But the load testing on the system says that the system was able to process the rate that was coming in. The challenge was that effectively we stopped the applications coming in simply using the DNS. But I think the learning on that is it's an unfortunate, but again, you know, it means it's less likely that we and others will make that mistake in the future.
So, but the load testing didn't pick up that it thought there might be a cyber attack, but when it went live in real time, it did.
Yeah, but I guess that's because the load testing was probably based will have been based on those applications who had made it to the system, right, and effectively the throttle applied before it made it to the system. Right. In that, it basically was the number of connections going in. Again, I'm confident that the system was fully geared up to manage that number of processes.
Okay, thanks for that.
Thank you. Well, look, my final question is, again, turning to the summary of the projects which you issued to us back in July. There was one project on there which, you'll forgive me, caught my eye, and that was the enhancement and replacement of the CalMac Ferries booking system, which was started, I think, in 2016, but the date set on the note for completion and presumably going live was November 2022. We are now in December. Can you assure us that that system is now live?
I'm going to be very grateful for Sharon's pick this one up.
So the system isn't yet live. They are planning to go live in the spring. They are currently undergoing staff training. They have to they're training up about 700 staff on the new system. And their intention, as I say, is to go live in the spring. We don't have an exact go-live date yet. They have another pre-go-live gate review coming up post-Christmas.
So why in the note does it tell us that the expected start date is November 2022, not spring 2023?
Because the note that you've got was for the update that was in July, not the December update, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, because you haven't issued that to us yet.
No, that's during the next couple of weeks.
Okay, so but I'm just trying to understand then. I mean, this is a project which started in 2016. So presumably there must have been an understanding that staff training was required before the system went live. And isn't that planned in advance of the system going live?
Yes, it is. But it's not the staff training that is that has slowed things down. They had done all of the assurance processes that they were due to do, and they did user acceptance testing over the summer that raised a number of issues that they wanted to resolve before they went live. So they've now resolved those user testing issues that have come up. And so that you wouldn't do the staff training until you've got your final, towards your final product that you're then going to roll out. So they needed to iron out these other issues first.
Why is it taking 6 years in the first place? Isn't that unusually long?
I don't have enough detail on the project to be able to answer that. We can certainly get more information for you.
Okay. So, I'm also bound to ask, is it on budget?
Yes, it is still within budget.
Okay. Well, look, thanks for that answer, and thanks for your other answers this morning. So can I thank Sharon Fairweather, Jeff Huggins, and Yorath Turner for your contributions this morning. I am now going to end the public part of this morning's session and go into private session. Thank you very much.